Welcome to today's tutorial. Today's tutorial we learn a little bit more about how we build actually libraries, and then we learn in a second task how to create makefiles which allow us to automatize building process and make it efficient. So without further ado, let's get starting with compiling of libraries. So we have been using libraries when we program C a lot. So we had, for example, used the math library a little bit, the standard C library quite a lot. How are those libraries actually made? This, by the way, will complete your training to master the C programming language and to understand the concepts that are relevant in your computer system, maybe Windows, Macintosh, or Linux. Okay, so in Windows, what we have are so-called DLLs, which are dynamic link libraries. And in Linux, we have the so-called shared objects. Yeah, these concepts are very similar, albeit the way you create them are slightly different. We will, of course, focus here on Linux, because that's our development environment in this term. So what's important when you try to build a library is that you need additional compiler steps and several new flags that you haven't used before. The general steps to create a library is as follows. You create a header file with a public API. Then you include all the header files in this implementation of this public API that would be needed to understand any code that is found as part of this header. Then we create the internal header file that contains more information, so it's used only inside the library to implement a library, but it shall not be exposed to a user. Then we implement the library in the C file, in more or multiple C files, and we will use a little bit this assert function, which allows us to check that the function is used correctly, that the programmer follows the contract of the interfaces, not inputting some random, unknown, or wrong data. Lastly, typically you create some unit tests for the library, which particularly is relevant for test-driven development. And yeah, so let's have a look at the code before we continue. So first, let's have a look at the library. So we see here our guards as usual. And then in my library, I wanted to use the bool data type. So I need to include this header file. And then I create here, you find I type define a structure, mystruct t, as mystruct t, but there is no declaration or definition of any variable of mystruct t. Now we don't know, and the compiler doesn't know here how this mystruct t is internally created. But it's actually not needed, because all we do here is we return pointers to this opaque data type. So as a user, you cannot manipulate this data type now, but it doesn't matter because you should use the library. And in our library, all we did is we prefixed this library with lib underscore, and normally that would be a useful name. Yeah, so here we create this new data type from a string, mystruct t, and then we do something with this object based on a boolean. And lastly, we want to create a string from our mystruct. Okay, so this is now our public API that we give to the user. Yeah, and users can use this. For example, here in my program, I can say lib test init hello from test 2, which returns my struct t pointer. And then I do something with this object, and then I'm done. Okay, and we include here lib.h, which was containing our declarations of this public library. Now we can have many programs. Here is now a test. Yeah, this is now a test that is done by the library itself. And when we use such a test, in this test we will use another header file, this libinternal.h. So let's have a look what libinternal actually does and how this works together with our implementation of the library. So this internal library header, it includes firstly this public header from the user, and then here we add additional functions that we may use in our library. Yet, and also it declares how the structure is layouted. And all we do here is we basically store a boolean b and we store our pointer to this string or character array basically. Okay, and let's have a look at the implementation, which is also just a dummy. The implementation of course uses an internal header because it needs to know how the structure looks like. And it runs here assert to check that the string is not null. Then we malloc here our data structure, and then we initialize this data structure by copying it over. This is a little trick. Copying over with the casting from this mystruct t structure, setting b to be true and the string to be, using string dub, a copy of this string given by the user. So str dub will copy the string, and then we lastly return the pointer p. And when we do something, all we do is we change value b to the value given by the user, and then we print the string value. By the way, you can think about if those functions are pure or impure, which is a good practice. So this function here, is this pure? Does it have side effects? Yes or no? This function here, the getString, all it does, it basically returns the pointer to the string, and it returns it as a constant pointer to a constant character, such that the user shall not modify it. Okay, so that's about this. So it's the code. Next, what we need to do is we compile this library, and the steps are as follows. First, we need to compile the objects of the library using position independent code, which is the flag fpic in GCC, and -c creates this object, the object files. And last step would be then to create a shared library from these objects using something like dash shared flag, and then we have to give it a name like the .so file. So let's have a look if we find this now in this compile sh file. So we include the current working directory, which is dash i dot. We compile this lib.c file using fpic. Then we create a shared file, mylib.so, integrating our lib.o object file. By the way, we could have included many object files here, building one library. Lastly, we build our test programs. They need to find the include directory and they need to find the library directory, both in the current working directory. We call the test application test one and the other one the use application. But we need to link now this new library. So we say dash l mylib. And lastly, we use this flag here, wl dash dash r path, which basically tells the linker to look at runtime in this current working directory and for the library. Normally, this is not needed because you would use system libraries, but in this case, we use a user-defined library, so we need it. So let's have a look what's going to happen when I run compile.sh. Here we go. Now I see here I have mylib.so and I have test 1 and use. Let's run use. Hello from test 2. What does test 1 do? Hello world. Okay. So that's pretty much it. So that's all the code that's here. What you now should do, you should now use these tools that we got to know last week, which is LDD and NM, on these created objects to inspect the output. What LDD use. We find out that we actually use my library here, and we can use NM, right, on any object like lib.o to see what's inside. Please do so also for the executables and try to understand what's here. And lastly, if you have time, please extend the library with the function myfree or libfree that then frees all the allocated objects correctly. So the objects that we have created in lib test init in particular. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Let me lastly show as well why we distinguish in the test and include this libinternal. By using libinternal, remember we have the full description of our data structure. So what we can do is, when we call a function like libtestInit, we can call the function stringComp on this object t, its string inside there, and compare this if this actually matches our expectation, which is that we have stored now hello world. Yeah, and then also when we do something else, we can always call the stringComp function and check if this works as intended. Yeah, let me run again, you know, test one. It says hello world and returns zero probably. Let me make now a mistake in libinitTest, which was implemented in lib.c. So instead of calling string dub string, what we do is we call here string dub test. Now I compile it, I run it, and you get here the message test.c in line 9, there's a problem, the assertion string comp hello world failed. Okay, so now we see that we basically have written very basic tests, a very basic test here, which helps us to make sure that the library works as intended. Okay, so remember now what you should do. You should try to understand this example, of course, and then if you have time, implement this lib free function, yeah, lib test free, and then probably it needs a my struct value, right? Think about this and then implement it. Good luck. And if you have any questions, talk to us.